Hello, my quilting friends. My name is Leah Day. We are ready to start quilting. My quilt is mounted this way on the frame, so I'm going to be starting with this design here in this corner, and that is the arcs border. So we're going to stitch out the design in rectangles. I'm going to show you how to stitch out in small spaces, as well as utilizing the full space in the frame to stitch verticals as well. If you have a bigger long arm, this is definitely going to be for you. So the first thing we're going to do is tap on the pantograph option, and then we're going to set our safe area. And yes, you do want to set your safe area to be the full length and width of your frame. However much space you have to quilt in, you want to have the maximum amount of space to play. So once you set your safe area, this is what your screen's going to look like, and it's going to come in the full width, whatever you set your safe area to be. That full width is going to be pretty big, but we don't actually want to plan our designs to be in that much space. We want it to be set by the space we are quilting. So down here on the quilt, I'm going to take my ruler, I'm going to place it over the space and measure it. I'm using my long arm just so that way you can see what I'm doing. And this is 11 inches wide and 4 inches tall. So what I'm going to do is go in here and I'm going to set that total width to 11. And this is why you're going to need that ruler, so that way you can check in on your spaces and know how big they are. Now, the height is going to be a little funny. I'm going to set that to 3.5. And the reason being is I like a little bit of a margin on the height of my spaces. And I'll explain that a little bit more as we start stitching out our designs. Now I'm going to tap on Select Pattern. And this very first pattern is the arcs border. It's right there. And I'm going to tap Open. So there we go. That is one pattern placed in that space, and that looks pretty good. You know, I like to quilt though a little bit more densely. I'm quilting roughly on a half to quarter inch scale on this quilt. So I'm going to do two. I just hit that plus button, so that way I have two patterns now. And I really like that. I think that looks really pretty. If you want less quilting, of course, you can always dial that back down to just one. So I'm going to set that to two. I think that looks pretty. And here's what's important. We are going to hit place as single pattern over here, because basically what we did, we used the Panto tool to take two continuous line designs, merge them together, so that way it's thinking it's one design. And now we can take this and place it on our quilt. So this is what's important. I was telling you how I wanted that little bit of a margin here on my quilt. What I mean by that is I want a little bit of a gap between the design and the top edge and that bottom edge of that space. But I want the design to start and stop right on this narrow edge. I like the idea of the design looking like it's stitched across and then actually truly overlapped by that neck, you know, basket weave. It's a basket weave quilt, so I want it to look like that design comes through and then is overlapped by that design there. So how I'm gonna do this, how I'm gonna set up my placement, is I'm gonna rotate over, just roll over, and I have the couching foot from the 9-piece attachment foot set here. And I have that set because it has a really tiny hole down in there where I can see exactly where that needle is going to drop. And I'm going to roll over so that that is lined up right on that line. So I am starting right on that edge. Now back here, I'm setting up so I'm not right on the edge in the corner. I'm actually a quarter inch down, and that's exactly where I want it. So here on the screen, I know that's the placement node that I want. I'm going to tap it. It's going to immediately pop the design over and start setting it up in this place. Now, you might be wondering, why am I going to bother with all four attachment nodes? I'm going to roll over, get into the right position. In this case here, it's right on this narrow edge, but a quarter inch roughly from that bottom edge of that rectangle. And the reason why I do all four attachment nodes is, you know, fabric can get wiggly and it might not be 100% perfect. And this rectangle might have gotten distorted somehow. So I'm going to make sure that it is placed really nicely in this quilt by doing all four attachment nodes. So again, here, rolling back, making sure that that tiny hole is lined up right on that line. And I'm roughly like the back edge of this foot is roughly along this back edge. and I tap that last attachment node. Now, two things that are really important as you do this. Do not lean on your rails. Do not lean on your frame, because as you can see, that moves. That has a little bit of give to it. And if you are leaning on that, then that means that your placement will be off whenever you step back away from the frame and the machine starts running. So I always, sometimes I'll even grab a step stool whenever the design is far back on the frame, just so that way I'm not tempted to lean on that. And I'm sure that I'm going to get that accurate placement. Now, if you're not quite as nitpicky as me and you don't really care if the design is absolutely in the perfect spot, you can use a different foot. You do not have to have the 9-piece attachment foot set. I would say you could definitely use the ruler foot and get just as accurate placement. And then if you wanted to do your outline quilting with ruler quilting, you could use the ditcher ruler to then stitch an outline around this shape, around this rectangle. I'm going to continue using QCT because I really want to do almost as much quilting as I can with the software. So I'm going to not only stitch the design, I'm also going to do some outline quilting around that rectangle. So in order to do this, we're going to use another tool. It's in the toolbox. So I'm going to tap on that. So here's the toolbox. I'm going to go down to the marking tool. You can see we already have a number one here. And this does require a little bit of guesstimation. You want to kind of guess and know where the design is going to begin, which looks like it's going to be in that lower left-hand corner, and it's going to end in that lower right-hand corner. Roll over here, and I'm going to try and figure out exactly where I set that, kind of that lower left corner, a little bit off that edge, and I'm going to hit add. So that's where it's going to start. Okay, now I'm going to go down to the corner of the rectangle, just exactly on that corner, hit add again, roll all the way over to the other corner of the rectangle. And if anything, if I'm going to err on any side, it's going to be to the inside of the rectangle, to the inside of that light yellow rectangle, rather than to the outside in the red background, where I think that would be more noticeable if it was stitched off. This is exactly what I want to stitch in this rectangle. So over here, I'm gonna make sure that I have the pattern selected and also marking selected. So I'm sure I'm gonna be stitching out both of those things, and then I'm gonna hit quilt. So I hit quilt. Make sure you got everything out of the way, and also make sure that your needle is in the up position at this point. It's gonna ask you, of course, but it's always good to double check before you get to this screen. Now, one quick thing I forgot to check in on is settings, and this is really important. So I have my machine set to slow. It's just how I like to run it. I like it to run fairly slow just so it has the best stitch quality. I do a tie-off count of 2, and I do a micro stitch. This is just personal preference. And I have this set to do an automatic bob and pull, pause at trim lines, and to do 15 stitches per inch. So those are all of the settings that I use with QCT5. And now I'm gonna hit pull bobbin. What this is gonna do, machine's gonna turn on. It's going to first ask you if your needle is up. Like I said, I'm gonna say do not show that again, because I know if I am using QCT and kind of running with it, my needle is pretty much always gonna end up in the up position. So it's rolled over, it's gotten to the start point, it's needle down, needle up, and now it's gonna rotate over. Now this is where you can check yourself and check your placement. If you've just needled down and needle back up, and this is way off and not on the edge of that rectangle, well, you can just hit the back button, go back in, reset your placement nodes, and then get started again, because you know that the design is not quite fitting in the space properly. But this looks perfect. You see how that bobbin thread is pulled up exactly on that line. I'm so happy with that. Okay, now I'm gonna hit sew, and the entire design is gonna stitch out. It's gonna stitch through the entire rectangle, and then it's going to stop whenever it gets to that marking set. It's gonna need to be advanced, and you'll have to hit a button. You'll have to hit move to next. So I'm gonna let this stitch out, and then we'll meet up whenever that happens. So here we go. The design has fully stitched out, and now your screen will change to this. It'll say move to next. So you just tap move to next. If you were good on your placement, then it should have just been a little bit of a blip, a little bit of a move. As you can see, the machine hardly moved at all. And now it's ready to do that marking, that outline quilting. So I'm just gonna hit sew. I do not need to break thread because that start and end point was pretty much dead on top of itself. So just keep that in mind. Your goal is always to start that marking exactly where the design ends, so that way it continues seamlessly. Okay, so the design stitched, the marking stitched, we've got all done, and I'm gonna click finished back to pattern placement. And as you can see here, the screen is going to flick back and it's gonna be regulated precise and then whatever your stitch length is. In this case, it's 15 stitches per inch for me. Whenever it flips back and it no longer says quilt motion, that means that you have control over your handlebars again, meaning the buttons will work again. So what I'm gonna do is pull my bobbin thread up to the surface so that way I can tie off and bury those thread tails securely. So the first thing I do is I push the long arm away. This spools out the bobbin thread so that way I'm sure I have a nice long thread tail there. I pull the machine back and I put it right on top of where I ended that stitching line. So I'll bring that right to that spot wherever my stitching ended, needle down, needle back up, tug on that, and that's gonna bring up a loop. That loop is my bobbin thread. So I can clip that, pull the machine away, and then I'm left with the two thread tails from that ending stitching. It's a little bit confusing, takes a little bit of practice to get the hang of that, but I promise it's a great habit to get into. You can tie off and bury these thread tails so your quilting doesn't come out, doesn't unravel. Okay, so we have our design set up here. So what we can do is just take this design and move to the next rectangle. And this is exactly how you're gonna stitch all of the rectangles all the way down the row of your quilt. So if I was doing that, I'm gonna go back to placement. I'm gonna go back and reset this again, foot in the same position. I'm gonna shift this over, tap that top one, shift it again, tap that bottom one. But here's the thing, if we take a look at the marking is always going to retain the placement of where it was on the quilt. So we actually need to go into that marking tool and we need to click the button that says remove all. Because every time you move the design, you set that rectangle somewhere else, you're going to need to remove all of the marking of the one before and reset that marking in its new location. I'm gonna now stitch this design in this rectangle and then I'll grab my ditcher ruler and I'll show you the alternative. So I'll line up and try and get right on the outline. I'm gonna grab the ditcher ruler and this ruler has really nice evenly spaced etched lines, 1/4 inch away. I like to use this edge just because I can really easily see those lines and make sure I'm lined up nicely. And of course, this would be a lot more accurate and easy to use if I was using the ruler foot. That would give me 1/4 inch spacing. But I find that even with this couching foot, I can eyeball it and adjust as I go. And as you can see, that stitching is landing exactly on that outline. I like it. And this just takes a little bit more time. I do click the machine on and off as I go. I always put the ruler in my non-dominant hand, in this case it's my right hand, and then I operate the machine with my left hand, my dominant hand. Okay, so stitch over, get to that point, and then now straight down. So that is the alternative. If you don't want to use the marking tool, if you find that to be just not as accurate as you would like, you can also use ruler quilting instead. Okay, so let's talk real quick about the background. It is entirely up to you if you want to quilt these spaces or not. I decided to quilt my spaces with a design called sharp stippling. Basically, you just stitch a wiggly line and then you come to sharp points. And this is the only design in the quilt that I stitched freehand, meaning I did not use QCT. I just stitched this myself, shifting the machine around, come to a sharp point, wiggle down, wiggle through that area, and I'm always kind of thinking about keeping this on the same scale, the lines quilting roughly the same distance apart as what I've stitched with QCT. So if this seems, you know, like a little challenging to you, maybe don't have the freehand quilting skills, then understand that you can also do outline quilting with the marking tool. You could do an X through here using the marking tool. You could do some straight lines. There's lots of different options. Anything that you want to put in the space, actually. You could even place one of the smaller, simpler designs in this area, and that would be fine too. So now we know how to stitch designs that are long and horizontal. Let's go all the way back. I'm gonna hit X. And I'm going to come back to this screen where we originally started working with our pantograph. So I want to talk about placing a design into a space that looks like this. This is 4 inches tall by 3 inches wide. That needs to be three width, 3.5, 3.5. And as you can see, this design is a little bit skinny and a little bit tall. I think this looks good. It's ever so slightly distorted, but I think it looks good because it's gonna be consistent all the way across the quilt, which means that whenever I put multiple of these designs together to do my wider spaces, they're all gonna basically look consistent. They're all gonna look about the same. All right, so we're gonna do that same placement again, lining up that needle so that it's lined up with that edge of the rectangle, tap on my first placement node, roll that machine down, get it lined up again, tap that next placement node. And if your machine gives you a little warning, you know, something like, oh, it's out of the safe area or something, that just might mean that you're ready to advance your quilt. So don't worry about that. Just shift your quilt if you need to. This is what I love about the 21. You have so much space to play in before you have to do any advances. So that is that small design placed. Again, if I wanted to do some markings around it, I could, and then hit quilt. So I pulled my bobbin, got the machine ready to go, and it's gonna stitch this out. So every time that I have one of those little narrow spaces, I'm gonna have one on one end of the quilt and on the other. So at this point, I would go on ahead and have this basically created, have the design sized the right way. I go down to the other end of the quilt, place it, stitch it, so it's already done. So I'm gonna go in and select my pattern, and we are gonna put pattern C in this space. And I'm going to dial this down to just 2 because I think that's going to look the best. It's not going to be too squished together. And here you can see my total height, 3.5. My total width is 9. So just remember, it's going to look like you're stitching a horizontal. It's okay. As soon as you hit that place a single pattern, you can get to this screen and you see over here, we've got the ability to rotate it. So I'm going to tap on the 45, 45. And now my design is vertical, but it's all squished together. So what do I do now? All right, so I'm going to roll this over and I'm gonna set my placement marks. So again, lining up so that the needle is lined up with that skinny edge of the rectangle right on that outline, making sure that the foot is lined up over here. Just run through all of those placement nodes. So in order to stitch that, I just hit quilt. And now it will stitch out that design vertically. And the only limitation, like I said, is just making sure that your long arm is big enough to fit the design. You need that full 9 inches, plus enough space for your foot, plus enough space for the rails. You need a good bit of space in order to quilt that. I don't think that the Cunique 15 has enough space in the harp, plus everything else, in order to be able to quilt a full 9 or 10 inch design. So this looks good. I pull my bobbin and now I hit sew. So that is how I place my designs and stitch them in the basket weave quilt. Understand that those verticals are very, very easy to stitch if you have a smaller long arm. All you need to do is take your quilt off the frame, rotate it, and then all of those verticals will become horizontals and you can stitch them the same way as I showed at the very beginning of this video. So that's it for this video. My name is Leah Day, and until next time, let's go quilt.